give us a brief resume of yourself, and after that we'll take you through your CV, and then we'll go into the meat of the vetting itself.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Awal Mohammed Ibrahim, born 1961 at Kumungu in the Northern Region. I had my primary and secondary education, primary and middle school education at Tshugo Ankam Primary and Middle School, all in Tamale. I proceeded to Ghana Secondary School in Tamale for my ordinary and advanced level education. I also schooled at the Ghana Institute of Journalism. From there, I also went to School of Journalism in the Netherlands for my bachelor's. Went to the University of Wales in Cardiff for master's in journalism. The chairman also studied at the University of Ghana Business School, an executive MBA. Also schooled at Swiss Business School for master's in applied business research. At the same Swiss Business School, I did a doctorate in business administration. I'm awaiting the defense of my thesis. The chairman also had courses in Harvard Business School, business strategy, and Oxford Oil Management and Petroleum Management. Mr. Chairman, I've worked at different places. I've worked 21 years at Graphic Communication Group. I'm rising from reporter to managing director. I've worked at Chase Petroleum as MD, and I've set up companies, Marvel Group, until now as the Chief Executive Officer of Marvel Group. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chairman, thank you. Any role have you played in a public role apart from MD of Graphic?
No, Mr. Chairman.
What were you doing as Chase Petroleum as your mandate?
I was the managing director of the company. As MD, I was in charge of general direction and effective management of the business to achieve set targets.
January 1997 to December 1997, where you say you obtained your master's in international journalism at the University of Wales in the UK. And then September 1991 to June 1994, where you did your Bachelor of Arts in Journalism at the School of Journalism in the Netherlands. Going through your CV, at that same time, you indicate that you were the Upper West Regional Correspondent for the Daily Graphic between 1989 to 1998, a nine-year period. At the same time, you say that you were in Wales, UK, and Netherlands. So how could you be at all of these three places at the same time? Can you please explain what is happening? I'm not sure you have special omnipresent or magical abilities to be present at three locations at the same time. Please explain what is happening here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. During all this period, I had scholarship, and it was allowed to be given to obtain scholarship for further studies. And within every 3 years, one could be granted scholarship to study whether locally or abroad. So that's what I took advantage of and went for studies. I was still a staff of Graphic.
You were still a staff of Graphic. Okay, so we will, I'm sure we have your permission to carry out the needed amendments so that for clarity's sake. Your doctorate in business administration, you indicate that you are awaiting the defense. When is this decision expected?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That is, it's left to the school to decide it. But the graduation for the doctorate will be in August, September this year. So it's left to the school to tell me when they want to defend the thesis.
You do not expect this to interfere with your work if given the nod by this committee. How do you intend to combine?
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. It wouldn't affect it. It takes not more than 2 hours to defend the thesis. We've gone to and fro with the supervisors, and we've done a lot of work already. So it doesn't take more than 2 weeks to, 2 hours to defend the thesis.
So between now and August, you have only 2 hours outstanding, between now and August. We just want to have that clarity.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My external supervisor has already passed through, passed me through the first two stages, along the last stage. And after the last stage, they'll give me the data to defend the thesis.
Please come with us to page 3 of your CV. You indicate that between November 2011 to January 2017, you were chief executive officer. Do we take it that you are totally disengaged? And how did you disengage from the Marble Group?
I have built a lot of succession planning in my business. And over the last 1 year, I've been training some of my managers to take over. And they've effectively taken over the business as at 1st of February this year.
Mr. Chairman, finally from me, the nominee is totally silent on professional bodies he belongs to. I'm quite surprised. I thought you should at least belong to the GJA and the IPR, at least these two. Or have you relinquished your membership of these professional bodies?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I used to be GJA, IPR, and CIMG, but I haven't paid dues for many years, so...
So you are not in good standing.
I'm assuming strongly you've had some discussions with the president, President Nana Adudankwa, nominating you to the Ministry for Business Development. What role will you be playing? What has he made you understand will be your specific role?
My mandate per the president's discussion is to initiate policies and measures to achieve the best competitive stand for Ghanaian enterprises. The biggest problem we have is the capacity of the local enterprises. They cannot access the local international markets. My role, therefore, is to ensure that I achieve the best competitive value for Ghanaian enterprises so that they can compete locally and internationally. This is the main mandate.
Do you have any dedicated, normally we assume that an executive instrument will create that portfolio. Are there state or public institutions you anticipate will come under the exercise of your oversight in your responsibility as minister responsible for business development?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My mandate also includes attracting business investment to very key sectors of the economy. So the president has directed me to coordinate activities of GIPC, NBSSI, National Board of Small Scale Industries, MASLOC, and Export Promotion Council.
Does that include the Free Zones Board or not?
No, sir, Mr. Chairman.
I'm most grateful, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, my first question will flow from an answer you just gave about obstacles that the private sector in Ghana, private businesses, are confronted with. Can you give us a list of these obstacles, specifically these obstacles? What are they, and how do you intend to resolve these obstacles to help the private sector get around these obstacles?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think the key among them is registration of land is very important, permits for construction, access to cheap finance, and then capital, skills development. And then the macroeconomic environment in terms of taxes, in terms of utilities bills. These are some of the key areas. The ministry, if we are given the nod, the ministry would work in collaboration with other ministries like Attorney General's Department, Minister of Finance, local government, and the rest. And then the private sector, because they are the center of all this business. We can collaborate and design measures to progressively reduce these obstacles so that the private sector can have space to compete and grow. Thank you.
Chairman, if the nominee can provide further clarity, which obstacles, how do you intend to overcome the obstacles? We don't know, so share with us that I will do A, B, C to deal with the obstacles. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For instance, in Rwanda, if all the documents are set, a businessman can register a company in 2 days max. In Ghana, it takes more than 2 weeks. we need a single window. All the stakeholders in the region of business should have to come together to facilitate the realization of business. It's very important for us. There's also the issue of finance. It's very key to SMEs. We need to establish, we had a venture capital fund. We need to encourage our business to take risk and to find relatively cheap source of finance for our businesses to grow. So we need to get the banks and other financial institutions to let them appreciate the need for that and also strengthen the capacity of the private sector, because most of them do not have records. That's why the banks feel that they are not able to support them. So we'd improve the skills of the private sector and also collaborate with the Ministry of Finance and other financial institutions so I can develop access to relatively cheap source of capital to improve and support SMEs. Thank you.
10. There's an opportunity I want to give to the nominee to make a pitch for himself in terms of what you will say makes you the most suitable person to occupy this office as the Minister for Business Development. How successful will you say you have been in your own private business, the Marble Group? We know that you are the owners of the Finder newspaper. I'm not too sure how well it's doing in circulation and all of that. But how will you argue that you remain the best person to champion business development?
Chairman, I started from Graphic, and we were able to grow revenue by 100% in 4 years as MD. The records that we grew revenue by 100%. We brought a lot of initiatives. Like I said, we had a new press that we bought from our own local resources at 10 million euro. We had several other initiatives at Graphic. We have people's skills, competences. It's very important in the business to have people's skills, because we need to relate with people. You have the ability to inspire people, to lead them and motivate them to deliver. There'll be weak links in with management and with staff. You need to have the ability to pull the weak ones up and to encourage the strong ones to stay. So, Mr. Chairman, we have people's skills, very important. We have social capital skills, networking. In every business, you have stakeholders. Your ability to encourage stakeholders and engage them will give you access to valuable information and resources to manage the business. We also have a lot of relationship with development partners. We consulted for them over the years, and we know how they operate. As a private businessman, I have 4 successful companies. We're into real estate, we're into media, we're into printing, and we're into consulting. So, Chairman, the Finder newspaper is about the 3rd biggest subscription paper in this country in only 5.5 years. Our adverts, if you look at our paper, is very quality, and we have a unique selling proposition. So we have what it takes, given the nod, to deliver. We have people's skills, we have good networking ability, we have social capital, and we relate with everybody who matter in the business sector. Thank you.
Question. There's another opportunity that I want to give the nominee. You left the Daily Graphic in some controversy. A group calling itself the patriotic staff of Graphic, your own workers, issued quite a damning verdict on your tenure. They said that you had reduced circulation, dividend had dropped. Yes, you raised it, but it dropped, they say, from 800,000 to 40,000 in 2009. And they say that you were being investigated by the board and by the IOCO, the former SFO, by the time you resigned from Graphic. Are you able to tell this committee if closure was brought to these allegations? And what do you say to the patriotic staff of Graphic, since you have been heavy this evening on your glorious days at the Daily Graphic, where I worked with you as Deputy Minister of Information, and I remember you very well at the time. But how do you respond to this patriotic staff of Graphic?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, it was investigated. The letter was written. It was a letter written by one person. The board set up a committee, and the committee sat on the board 3 months, and I was exonerated. The board minister are there. I was exonerated 100%. It was done in 2009, and I left Graphic at the end of 2010. So I never had any issues with it. It was the same letter that Yoko, a then SFO, had. They invited me to the office. and they told me to respond. I also responded by in writing. They called me twice, and they never called me again. You know, so it took me almost 2 years since the letter appeared until the time I left. I left the graphic because I had a different career goal. After 21 years, I thought I should go and do something for myself. Thank you.
Chairman, it's not working. The business development portfolio is one of the new creations, the creations of the president, Nana Akufo-Addo. It's a portfolio under the office of the president. And budgetary allocations to such portfolios are always captured under the office of the president allocation. You have stated here that as part of your mandate, you are to develop 20 big companies. 20 big companies. I just want to know how you are going to do this. And is it part of the One District, One Factory commitment?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There's a lot of capital in the system. I mean, development partners are willing and ready if you have very bankable proposals. What we intend to do is to encourage matching to get similar businesses abroad to partner our local businesses so that they can transfer skills and transfer know-how. For example, in China, the Chinese invited German businesses to set up to help them with speed trains. And there was innovation and technology transfer. Today, China is the best in terms of speed trains. For example, over the years, we had Apostle Asafo Kantanka doing a lot of business, a lot of vehicles. You see, what we need, doing a lot of vehicles, but it's been the same old story. What we lack is the value chain. What we lack is the value chain. If we all support Apostle Asafo buying the vehicles and supporting him to improve the value chain. Value chain here means that source of raw material, innovation, and then access to market. I'm sure we're able to send Apostle Asafo and the vehicles very far. We could also set up a plant in Boko, in Tamale, and help Apostle Asafo to do bicycles and motorbikes. They're very common. If we're able to set up this and help him with innovation and technology and finance, we can go to Sahel, Burkina, Niger, Mali. These are all very important sources. So there's a need to match. The capital is not just coming from the government, but we have to get appropriate, responsible foreign partners who can match our local businesses. And our business need to be competitive and ambitious. We can't keep on operating very small companies, and when the owners die, the companies die. We need to have global businesses that can compete. And that's what we intend to do by the big 20 companies we talked about. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Honorable nominee, I'm very much interested in this 20 big companies you have spoken about because of the job opportunities that it will create and the fact that it also helps improve the trade balance of our country. So all of us must be concerned about this very important issue you have raised. Do you have any idea as to how one of these companies will cost this nation?
Mr. Chairman, we intend to ensure that we either grow them from beginning or look at those that are already existing and to support them. Ghana has some competitive advantage. Look at pharmaceuticals. They have potential that can grow. Real estates, ICT. We might not know the exact amount of it, but when we sit in the office, we can work it out and ensure that we get the funding for that.
I ask this question because, Honorable Nominee, as we speak, preparations of the budget is underway. And if indeed, per the mandate given you, you stated that you have to deliver this 20 big companies within 4 years. That's exactly what you said. So, it shouldn't be in the budget. Thank you very much. So I wanted to know whether some studies have been done on this.
with respect to the locations, how much it will cost us, so that we can have an idea as to how much is going into it, so that when the budget is presented before the House and we don't see anything about this, we can raise questions and then find answers from some of the listeners.
So it's private sector led. It's private sector led. All we have to do is ensure that the private sector's competing capacity is enhanced. It's private sector led.
Then my last question, Mr. Chairman. On the 12th January 2017, when His Excellency the President was announcing your nomination, the President first and foremost made a statement, quote unquote, "You are welcome to the political world." Do you remember? You remember? No, I'm laying a solid foundation like you did the other day.
Ignore him.
The President went on to say that you are an extremely successful businessman. That was what the President said. And he added that you have very wide exposed, you are very wide exposed in the private sector of this country. He added that you have tremendous record in the, you're asking of the source. You are not in charge, so I have to ignore you. So the President created the impression that you are a very resourceful business person in this country. Can you prove to us this successful business track record of yours?
Yeah, he has told us what he has done. Is in answer to Honorable Okudzeto, he gave us. So I'll give you one more chance. Ask another one last question, and then.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I respect your ruling, and I'll ask a different question. But I wanted to find out from the nominee how successful he has been in the business world. Because the president premised his statements on the fact that he has been a successful business person. And therefore, going into that ministry, he will bring to bear the experience he has accumulated over the period within the sector. That's the reason why I asked the question. It's very important. But because the speaker has ruled, the chairman has ruled, I'll go to another area. Honorable nominee, when the Minister for Trade appeared before the committee, Honorable Alan Chematin, we asked him about the relationship between the Trade Ministry and that of the business development portfolio. And then he described the business development portfolio as a liaison officer. But today, from the way you are speaking, it's like you are also going to work in the same business arena with the Trade Ministry. So would you accept this description of being a liaison officer as accurate, looking at what you are telling us today?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, governance is a cross-functional thing. It's cross-functional. One ministry cannot, or agency cannot do it alone. We need to collaborate with every ministry, department, agency to improve the productive capacity of the private sector, to make them assess local and international markets. Our mandate is to collaborate with every ministry and to ensure that the mandate given us is successful. Make the private sector thriving, let them expand, let them employ people, and improve the lives of Ghanaians. I know Mr. Alam Trent is a gentleman who will collaborate and make sure that we bring results to Ghana. Thank you.
Honorable nominee, congratulations on your appointment. And thank you for the free advert that you did for Kantanka Automobile. Very much appreciated. I have one very important question for you. Your designation is going to deal with business development. The survival of many companies, SMEs especially, has been an issue of funding and accessing credit for their businesses. Many are really either consumed by interest from these credit facilities and eventually have to fold up, or would have to depend on the little capital they can raise themselves. Capital and credit facility availability is very key to the designation that you've been given by the president. I want to find out, what are the steps or the mechanisms that you put in place to ensure that in creating many businesses, to make them competitive both nationally and internationally, we could give them the necessary credit facility to operate?
I think the first point of call is to improve the capacity of the private sector. I think the businesses, they don't have access to most credit also because they have problems of bookkeeping and in-house matters. The first point of call is to, if we are giving the nod, is to make sure that they will improve their capacities to keep books and to compete. We'll do what we call a lock-in. We invite all the financial institutions with the private sector to ensure that we find out their problems and make sure that we take measures to improve them. If we improve their capacity at that level, they maybe have access to loans. The banks don't want to give because they're not sure that they can recover their loans. That's why they ask for big collateral. So the first step is to improve on the capacity of the private sector, the businesses, so that they can keep good books, they have skills to assess the loans. So it's one key area. We also want to have a pool of funding. There are funding pools all around. We need to assess those pool of funding to support capacity building and skills development of the private sector. We think this is the beginning, and we collaborate with the Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Trade Industry, and other agencies and ministries to have a pool of resources that the private sector can assess and improve upon their productive capacity. Thank you.
One that has been created, do you think that you'll be reinventing the wheel, or that is something totally different that you're bringing on board? Is it that it's been done in a different way and you're improving on it, or it's a totally new leg that you intend to develop and develop well?
SMEs everywhere around the world are the bedrock of business. In Ghana, the SME sector provides over 80% of jobs and over 60% contribution to GDP. We cannot leave such a sector into the big organograms of traditional ministries. The ministry would focus on the competencies, opportunities, and challenges of the SME sector and that develop appropriate strategies and change programs to improve them. So what we intend to do is to complement what other ministries are doing. We cannot leave such a sector alone. It will not work. For 60 years, we've been implementing measures, and the SME sector is still struggling. So we need a change focus, a focus that understands the problems and challenges of the SME sector and fashion out policies and initiatives to improve upon it. And in doing this, the ministry cannot do it alone. You need to collaborate with the administration to improve upon the product sector. Like I said, ensuring that they can compete, their capacity to compete is the most important challenge we have. So we tend to do that. Thank you.
SMEs and the support you intend to give them in the area of public procurement or government contracting, you find that many of our companies are not able to bid for these contracts. And so you see many foreign companies taking up the job. I believe that we want to encourage these SMEs in other aspects, including bidding for government contracts. How do you intend to build their capacity to be able to compete for local contracts as well as international contracts?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Capacity is everything. They are not able to compete because they lack what it takes to compete. We need to systematically but consistently improve on their capacity. We need to let them think big. We need to let them have a strategic focus. It should not be a short-term business. SME, every business should have a very long-term strategic focus, and that's what I intend to do. If you give them a long-term strategic focus, they improve their capacity and they can compete for local and international contracts. Thank you.
Today I'm taking after the minority leader. My last one. Do you have any specific plans for women in business? How you would encourage more women, how you intend to also make the level, the field a level playing ground for women to also excel in business. Do you have any such plans to encourage women in that field?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We, as I said earlier, we start from the schools. We intend to roll out the school incubator program and talent hunting in various tertiary institutions. And we intend to make women form not less than 60% of those targets. We help them to develop projects that we turn into business plans, and we support this best plan to incubate and grow. So we start from the tertiary institutions across the country. Hopefully, within 4 or 5 years, 60% of entrepreneurs in this country, successful entrepreneurs, will be women. Thank you.
Yes, I'm a minority
leader. Chairman, I'm joining you to congratulate Awal Mohammed Ibrahim. He's among very few people recognized at this level to play a role in the government of President Nana Akufo-Addo. In your CV, page 9, I've been speaking to Professor Kweku Etuehinejima. Is his school noble or Nobel? Since he's your very good friend, I'm sure I'm right. The E will come before the L. Don't you think so? You think so?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, so the appropriate thing will be done. Now, I have an understanding that your role as Minister for Business Development, to choose your own words, will be to enhance the competitiveness of Ghanaian enterprise. Now, let me just take you to South Africa, not even America, where you are seeking to enhance business competitiveness. You have a businessman in South Africa who borrows at 4% interest rate, or in the US. You have a Ghanaian businessman who is borrowing at 23% interest rate, who is not paid by government, and government I mean in the last decade, for 2 years, having executed a contract or supplied something to Materia. What will you do for the survival of those businesses in terms of wanting to enhance their competitiveness? Because if a contract is opened, it's open to the world, international competitive bidding. How will you get the Ghanaian entrepreneur to be competitive compared to that person relative to the interest rate pertaining in Ghana? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, interest rate is a function of macroeconomic dynamics. I think as government works towards improving the macroeconomic environment, our interest rates will fall, and we can take advantage of that. But the most important thing is to develop the capacity of the private sector person. That's the problem we have in this country, develop the capacity of the private sector person to enable him compete. If you are able to improve their skills, that's one. Two, as I said, is hand-holding. We need to hand-hold our private sector and businesses to compete. It's done everywhere. You can't just leave them and think that they can compete with the giants. We need to support them. It's done everywhere in the world. We have to handhold our private sector, our private businesses, give them the resources, give them the skills and competences to also compete globally. That's what I think we intend to do, Mr. Chairman.
Chairman, I heard you reference Dangote Jaspon in terms of Honorable Eric's question on your 20 big businesses. Let's just take you in your own corridor. You grew up in Dagbang. You had the Alhaji Midas, Alhaji Smanzo, Kole, the Yahya Idis, and then your own father, Ara Alassan and Co. Relative to your thesis of owner and success of businesses, what advice will you have for many of those enterprises that upon the exit of their owner, we saw the collapse of those enterprises? And what will you do to assure the revival of many of those entities that are still functional?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Chairman, succession planning is key. Most of these businesses have collapsed because they never had succession. And some of the thesis we saw, the studies, even when owners knew that they were about to die, they never really had succession planning. They never believed in it. So we need to encourage business owners to start to do planning succession long, even before they get to 60 years. And planning is not just about writing. It's about grooming one or two persons for a very long time and collecting the values of the business in them. Because SME or businesses, it's not only about profits. It's all about maintaining family values from one generation to another. So, Chairman, succession planning is very important. Then avoiding sibling rivalry. What we also found out from research that there are a lot of sibling rivalry among siblings. And if you're referring to whatever, those are the names we mentioned earlier. Siblings are not together. They think that the father is gone and they must tear themselves apart. So we must have a good succession planning and make sure that we minimize sibling rivalry. This would enable the business to grow from one generation to another. Thank you.
Is it not the case that many of these businesses were not developed as family businesses, but as individual businesses, from your own experience? Isn't it the case?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The family business, they were family businesses. The father or the owner starts it, and then he invites the children to also join. And at this stage, he cannot do it alone. So I think that it starts as an individual business and grows to family business. We need to ensure succession planning and to minimize sibling rivalry to ensure continuity of business when the founder exits.